Just by looking at the view, feels peaceful and tranquil. Today, we are back with another structure which doesn't have conventional beams and columns, which is Lotus Temple, situated in India. Foremost, let us know the backbone behind making this structure. Architect Faribos Saba, construction by L&T, and structure engineer was Flint and Nil. They have won several awards for this creation. So let us go through today's contents. There will be a short introduction to the structure. We'll learn about its architecture, what are the materials used, how is the structure formed, and how did its construction progressed. And last but not the least, some bonus facts. You must have already seen the disguised lotus hidden in the structure. So, this lotus has a fixed number of 27 petals. These 27 petals are divided into 9 sides, each side having 3 different petals. As we can see, they are indicated by 3 different colors, blue, purple, and yellow. The smallest one are the entrance leaves or petals. Next one are the outer leaves covering the interior hall, and the tallest ones are the inner leaves. Height of entrance petal is 7.8 meter. That of outer petal is 22.5 meter and the tallest one is 33.6 meter. The total height of structure resembles a 10-story building. Can you imagine how big it is? This lotus is then surrounded by 9 symmetrical pools and a bridge to reach inside, just like a natural lotus. Important factors considered in designing the structure fall under principles of architecture. First one, beauty and form. The temple is surrounded by 9 large pools of water that not only enhance its beauty but also play a role in the natural cooling system of the hall. In plan, its form is composition of circles and circular segments. To be noted, the resulting geometry was so complex that the plans for the temple took 2.5 years to complete. Now, the second principle is symmetry and rhythm. Here, we can see a radial symmetry. What exactly is radial symmetry? Radial symmetry refers to the balanced arrangement of similar radiating elements such that the composition can be divided into halves by passing a plane at an angle around a center point or along a central axis. Just like this line is dividing the plan in halves. These 3 petals with each pond have been repeated symmetrically at regular intervals, creating a rhythmic pattern. Rhythmic pattern provides continuity and leads us to anticipate what comes next. Now, scale and proportion. An important aspect as per the practical needs. As we can see, the structure looks like a monument standing tall, but if you take a look at its entrance, a person wouldn't feel uncomfortable with the tall height because the entrance is same as any other entrance of 4 meter height. Once you enter the main prayer hall, the sense of monument continues with the hall almost 40 meter high. Also, the hall can seat almost 1200 people at a time. Guess what we are looking at? Yes, materials. The surface of the house of worship is made of white marble, which was brought from the Penteli mountain in grease. Not just the surface, but white marble also covers the interior floors, while the insides of the petals are bush hammock concrete instead of marbles. The walkways and stairs in the podium are finished in the local red sandstone. You see how the white marble and white concrete is used in the same structure effectively? The interiors of all the shells have a uniform bush hammered surface of exposed concrete in which the architectural pattern can be seen. All the beams of the shells up to the level of the radial beam are white concrete, and to avoid cracks and fissures caused by retraction, which is usually seen in a concrete, a mixture of M30 was used. Keeping in mind that the content of cement must be less than 500 kg per meter cube and the water content be reduced to a minimum. These are very necessary steps. The 300 ton reinforcement used in the structural framework of the white concrete shells as well as the connection cables is galvanized to prevent long-term oxidation. These small details such as corrosion should be taken care of at the beginning itself. This teaches us how the minute details need to be analyzed earlier. A fact is coming up. Ice melt water was used in the mix to take care of the hot weather in Delhi to cool the concrete. That brought down temperature of concrete from 40 degrees to 25 degrees. If one resides in Delhi, they must know the severity of temperature. Now we have approached to the important part, which is nothing else but structure. The non-conventional curvy shape of the structure was converted into a definable geometrical shapes for calculation purpose, such as spheres, toroids, cylinders and cones. Now let us simplify this complex geometry, which is described as below. Arch soffits have a parabolic cone shape. Then spheres, cylinders, toroids and cone are given for the inner leaves. And the interior dome has 9 interesting spheres. Now let us explore each part of the structure one by one. First is entrance leaves and the outer leaves. The surface is created by the shell on each side of the entrance ways, and the outer leaves are formed by spheres. So these were made by spheres of different radius, with their centers located at different points of the interior of the building. Because we can see the shape, it is concave. The diameters of the spheres have been fixed to satisfy the structural consideration of the varying thickness of the petals. We can see that this complex geometry requires a lot of precision in its formation. Second, arches. Now, here, arches has played a very important role because the entire structure load, not entire but almost structure load of the temple's interior space is supported by 9 arches which spread out around the central hall, located at angular intervals of 40 degrees. The lotus temple forms of these arches are created by flat, conical and cylindrical surfaces. We can say that these arches act as columns and beams in the structure. Now, what are the basic aspects for designing a building? Dead load, live load, wind load and earthquake load. In this case, these 4 were the main considerations for the analysis of the structure, where the wind tunnel test was done in Aeronautical Engineering Department at Imperial College, London. All these things were designed with the help of tubular steel glazing frames, finite element analysis, equivalent grillage models for shells in the computer program, and quadrilateral element. Scaffolding. What is it? Basically, it is a structure made for construction workers to carry out work smoothly. Formwork will be the next, but let's see what is scaffolding. The Lotus Temple's timber scaffold. So here the timber scaffolding was used, and it was constructed to allow the craft workers to build having limited knowledge of parametric shapes. So as we know, workers don't have skilled knowledge, but we can provide them something by which the work can still be done with perfection. Now comes formwork. Can you guess from this picture what is formwork? It's basically a support like structure, a mold one, to acquire the desired shape of any structure. And that is why whatever our structure will look like in the end will depend on the precision of formwork. Formwork needs to be designed precisely, as we have seen just now. And here the limit for any error was only 3 mm. For the assembly of the formwork of the leaves and interior dome, they had to keep in mind the following factors. First, the cementing of the storerooms had to be done 3 at a time, so that the lateral loads of the individual supports of the formworks would be reduced as much as possible. Once completed, the concrete external surfaces were covered with burlap and cured for 28 days, keeping them continuously wet by means of a fixed sprinkler system in the upper part of the shells. Construction joints were to be avoided as much as possible, in order that the exposed concrete surface would show no other lines apart from the architectural pattern. In the inner interior panels, the construction joints were located above 24.8 meters. In the interior dome, the formworks were designed in such a way that the wooden beams would support the panels rather than the usual way in which it would be supported by the steel structure. So the interior formwork of each petal was fixed from the base up, taking into account that they must stay perfectly aligned. Moving on to the next part, that is sequence of the construction. When it comes to building a huge and complex structure, there should be a plan. One cannot randomly go and fix the structure. So, here was Lotus Temple's progression plan. The basement and the interior podium were built first. From there, to raise the arches and shells, the structure was divided in parts, bearing in mind that when the formwork was removed, the constructed part would support itself until the next part was complete. The structure was divided in the following way. We have seen before that arches take the entire load of structure. No doubt they had to be built first. The 9 arches were built one after the other until the circle was complete. The dismantling of the soffit of each arch was done once the adjacent arches could provide the necessary resistance. Inner leaves, radial beams, and central axis. These were built secondly. Once all the arches were completed, the interior steel structure of panels was raised. 3 frames were mounted simultaneously and raised with 2 elevators to the level of the radial beam. The process was repeated until all 9 segments were in place. The insertion of central axis was an independent operation, after which all panels were placed to connect the central axis through the radial beams. Now, the interior dome. After fixing interior panels, the steel cladding was modified and the folds of the shells of the interior dome were made, one after the other. For each shell, three folds, the contour ribs first and then the rest of the assembly. The process was repeated until all shells were completed. Now comes the exterior part, excess and outer leaves. The construction of the outer leaves in the entrance and the exterior ones were completed in tandem, along with the inner leaves and the dome. Firstly, the two leaves of the entrance and an intermediate external one were mounted. From there, they alternated the rest of the leaves of the adjacent entrances and the exterior ones. As the concrete set, the formworks were removed and moved to the next set of leaves. Let's move on to the bonus facts, as that's how the construction concluded. Bonus fact number one. Solar power was generated, is generated in fact, by solar panels on the building. The temple uses around 500 kilowatt of power, about which 120 kilowatt is generated by own. Fact number two, passive cooling technique. Cool air or heavy air is drawn from the bottom openings and hot air, which is a light air, is emitted out from the top. This process is reversed in humid days. Temperature being a huge problem in Delhi, to find a cool or at least less hot place is like a destination. This technique have definitely attracted people to cool themselves down. Now, bonus fact number three. Light in interiors, skylight. Imagine providing electrical lightning all the time in this huge monument. It's gonna cost gold mine. This was a smart move of providing illumination through skylight. The central bud is held by 9 open petals, each of which functions as a skylight. The interior dome, therefore, is like a bud consisting of 27 petals, and light filters through these inner folds and is diffused throughout the hall. That's the end. Thank you. As we all know, like, share, subscribe if you like, and also comment your suggestions. Bye-bye.